Happy Valentine's. Nice to see everybody in red. Looks good, looks good. Amen. Well, it's officially a construction site. Once wood starts showing up, and if you were here yesterday, sawdust was flying, hammers were swinging, nails, everything. So we've actually got one side done and well on our way. So thanks to everybody that came out yesterday. It was actually a great day. But as we were doing that, I thought of the movie, The Money Pit, because I was the one messing around with the rugs, and I thought of that scene when Tom Hanks walks into the room, and he just starts to sink into the carpet, and he's stuck there. Now all I need to do is have the Care Bears show up and talk to me, right? But if you remember the end of that movie, for those of you that have seen it, if not, at the end of the movie, it was this couple that during the construction of this house, they bought it, and then they had to renovate it, and just a ton of work had to go into it. But life happens, right? They get into problems, and they're going to part their separate ways, right? He's mad at her, she's mad at him. And the last scene, the contractor, who's a bit of a knucklehead, everybody thinks he's this, you know, goof and really doesn't know much, but he actually, of course, has the words of wisdom. But he says, when the two of them, he says, well, I got the key, I'm going to leave it here. He says, you know, he says, I didn't think this job was going to get done. But when there's a strong foundation, you can rebuild anything. You know, and it's kind of tongue-in-cheek. He's speaking to them, of course, and he walks out, and it's a beautiful scene, and they reconcile, and they love one another, and they have the wedding, and everything is good. But that's true. If there's the strong foundation, you know, then everything okay. And, of course, you know, the strong foundation we're talking about is Jesus Christ. And we have that strong foundation. And, you know, when I thought of the parable with the wise man that built his house upon the sand, right? The wise man built his house upon the rock, the foolish upon the sand. And essentially, that's the foundation that we're talking about. The foundation, again, it's not like it's this inanimate object. The foundation, it's your life, right? Just like the house, it's your life, it's the life lived. And the one that built the house on the rock was the one that heard the words of Christ and then doeth them. The one that built the house upon the sand, the one that didn't have the right foundation, they heard the words of Christ, they just didn't do them. So the strong foundation, again, it's a life lived. It's our ability to live the life like Jesus Christ. And actually, Paul actually says that. I believe it's in 1 Corinthians 3. I just want to look at that one verse because it's also a very powerful verse. Chapter 3, verse 11. For other foundation no man can lay that is laid. So there's a foundation that's already laid. You can't lay it. No other man can possibly lay it. It's already laid, which is Jesus Christ. Makes sense, right? And it's if you actually go up to the preceding verse, it says that ye are God's building. Who made the building? God. Who laid the foundation? God. What foundation did he lay? He laid Jesus Christ at the foundation of your house this morning. You have a foundation. It is Jesus Christ. He says, you say, well, I'm really not sure, Pastor. Does that apply to me? That's a fair question, but let's answer the question. Let's go to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, verse 11. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond or free, but Christ is all and in all. Who doesn't have Christ? Well, according to this verse here, Greek or Jew, Baptist or Catholic, circumcised or not circumcised, Jew or not, barbarian, just somebody that's, you know, not evil, Scythian, someone that's rude and nasty, you know, someone that's in bondage, someone that's not in bondage, whether you're Italian, whether you're Irish, whether you're from China, whether you're from South America, whether you're from this church, that church, I don't care where you're from, who you are, what you believe, what you don't believe, Christ is all and in all. That's at the foundation of every human being. That is a strong foundation. As though God would make a building and not lay a strong foundation in somebody else, that's ridiculous. A loving God built the foundation. The foundation is Jesus Christ. And essentially here in Colossians, he's talking about getting rid of the old man and putting on the new man. The new man, which is Christ. Because he even says that. He says, look at verse 8. He says, but now ye also put off. Again, we're just taking off an old nature. It's the old man. And what are we supposed to put off? Put off anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Verse 9, lie not to one another. So if Jesus Christ is my foundation, I ought not to lie?
No, you really ought not to lie. Well, that makes sense.
Seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds. It means when I didn't realize that my foundation is Jesus Christ and I lived as the old man is my Adam nature. That's the old man. The old man's Adam. He's the oldest man. That's it, right? If he was the first man. The old man, those deeds have to go away, which are just, again, it's when I don't have the understanding of the foundation of Jesus Christ that's inside of me. He says, I got to put that away. And what's the foundation? It's Christ. It's truth, though. That's why he's saying not to lie to one another. You remember when Paul was in prison? He was in prison and the angel of the Lord came to him. And what did the angel of the Lord say to him? He says, hey, Peter, hurry up. Put your belt on and put your shoes on and let's go. And Peter was like, okay. He put his belt on. He put his shoes on. What happened? He walked out of that prison. You want to walk out of your prison this morning? You got to put on your belt. Now, what's the belt? Well, Ephesians says that you are girded your loins with the belt of truth. Just tell the truth. Just be honest. Then he put your shoes on. That's the walk. It's your life. It's your life. So the foundation is truth. It can't be apart from truth. That nature, that old nature, that Adam nature, the old man, he's put that off. Put that off already. You put on the new man, which it is Christ. He is in all. That is the foundation. The foundation is truth. And apart from that, if I don't, what happens? I usually wind up in prison. I don't tell the truth, I usually wind up in prison. Because what happens once I tell the first lie? There's got to be a second one coming to cover the first one. It's this, you know, Isaiah talks about it. It's the refuge of lies that we create. We think we create this refuge and like we're going to be protected from these lies. Because again, I got to lie to God first before I can even lie to anybody else. And we create this false sense of protection, this false refuge. But then thank God, because he comes along and he says, in my due time, I'm going to take it all down. And actually, Habakkuk talks about that. He says he takes it all down. For what purpose? He says, so you'll find the foundation. Get back to the foundation. Let's get back to the basics. What are the basics? Christ. Jesus Christ. Christ is in all. In all. I don't care who you are. I don't care what church you go to. I don't care what you believe, what you don't believe. It don't matter. Christ is in all. That's a strong foundation. No other foundation can a man lay. So even when I don't believe the right things, and even in my ignorance and silliness, I apply something wrong to that foundation, you can't add to it, you can't change it. That's what he's saying there. You can't create the foundation. God created the foundation. Come on. And the foundation, of course, it is Jesus Christ. And I believe, again, the strong foundation, it is a life lived. It's not just, again, like, you know, at the base of the house, no one can see it. No, it's because it's there that they can see it. It's because it's there that it is strong. Again, we hear the words of Christ and we do them. The one that doesn't, they build it on the sand. The sand is just the lies, man. On Christ, the solid rock I stand, on all around is sinking sand. What's the sinking sand? It's just, again, it's just my unbelief. It's just my not knowing. It's sometimes my silly lies. And why do we lie? I know why I lie. Pastor, I'm sorry. Yeah, I admit it. I lie. For preservation. To protect me. Self. That's why we lie, generally speaking. It's to protect self. It's a selfish nature. It's the old man. It's the Adam nature. Which God just takes it down because he realizes you're trapped in a prison. Again, it's not, yeah, you're rotten, let's throw him in prison. No, what he shows you is how to get out of the prison. We put ourselves in the prison when we do that now. Because again, I have to lie to God first. I lie about the true nature and character of the foundation that's laid inside of me. And I lock myself in a prison. You lock yourself in a prison the minute you start to do that. Put on the belt of truth. Your loins. He's talking about the loins being girded. You know, the loins. You see the Roman soldiers? They'd have the loins. And it's, again, it's what are the loins? It's our ability to produce. Do you produce truth, a life lived, or do we produce a lie? You gird your loins with truth. With truth. This is what we produce. This is what we produce. And then what happens? Then you walk right out of the prison. There ain't no prison. Jesus even preached that message. How do you set the captives free? With truth. With truth. You shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Truth alone won't make you free. No, there's an intimate relationship with truth. That's what that word know means. It means I want to live like Jesus Christ. There's an intimacy. Truth alone, the Bible alone doesn't save me. There's gazillions of people carrying this thing and ain't saving them. It won't save me either. What saves me? When the Spirit of Christ inside of me that tells me and influences me to live my life, that's what saves me. Living like Him, hearing Him, and then doing what He says. That's what saves us. That's what sets us free and gets us out of the prison. That's what He tells us. Because apart from that, there is no life. He is the way, the truth, the life. What's sandwiched in between the way and the life? Truth. The way I live my life, my course of life, and then that becomes a life. There's no life. He says that. Apart from that, you have no life. The foundation. I believe this is the life that's lived. And John actually talks about it. We'll be in the third book of John. It's a short book. And I believe he's talking about the strong foundation. I believe he's talking about living this life. And how does this apply in practical terms to today? How do we do this today? I know there's a strong foundation here on Sunday. It's, right? I mean, if it's not strong here, it'll never be strong. The point is, I got to get it to be strong all the other days. And you know, we can't keep laying the foundation. We talked about that in men's Bible study. There's a foundation. Good. Can we move on now? Can we grow? Can we mature? Can we get stronger now? Can we start putting the walls up and the roof up and start getting bigger? And that's what John, I believe, is talking about here. The elder unto the well-beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth. Beloved, I wished above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. So here John, he's talking to Gaius. Gaius is, you know, somebody that loves the Lord, obviously, here. And John again, was establishing some of the churches. You know, the disciples established the churches, John and Peter and Paul and these guys. And so he's talking to Gaius here. But I love it what he says here. He says that above all things that I wish you should prosper. That word prosper actually means to travel well along the journey. That's what it means. It doesn't mean like I got a bunch of money coming out of my pocket. That's not what it means. It means to travel well for your journey. It means to travel well in life, to live like Christ. That's what he's talking about here. But apparently, he might not be in good health right now. I don't know, because he says, I really hope that your health would be good, just like your soul prospers. He's acknowledging that his soul is prospering. Your soul is what's healthy here. Man, I thank God for it. I pray your health mirrors that. That's a good prayer. That's a good prayer when someone can see and acknowledge your soul. That's prospering. And why was it prospering? We're about to get into that. He says, man, I hope your health will just look just like that. I hope your strength and your might looks just like your soul. We see, we get it wrong. We want the outward to look, oh, yeah, man, that looks good. And we think that's, no, it's soul first, man. Gaius obviously knew salvation. Gaius obviously had salvation. That's what was prospering. And let me tell you something. If your soul ain't prospering, guess what? You ain't prospering. If my soul don't prosper, I don't prosper. Soul first. Got to be sold out for God. That's what truly prospers. Anything else is not. But John is acknowledging this here. For I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee. Gaius, the truth that is in thee, they came and testified against the truth that was in thee. So truth was made visible. They were able to see truth in Gaius. They were able to see this strong foundation. It was made visible. It wasn't dormant and hidden inside. No, they were able to see this thing. That's what he's saying, that the truth that was in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. I lived my life. They were able to see this. It was visible. Why was his soul prospering? Because truth was made a reality. Truth became real through a life lived. That's what he says. Verse 4, I love verse 4. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. There is no greater joy. And doesn't Psalm say that the joy of the Lord is my strength? I'm glad he's happy. I'm sure glad God's happy. I'm not happy. No, what is he saying in that? That's what he's saying. I mean, like, if he's happy, how is that my strength? Right? You ever see somebody happy? That doesn't necessarily make me strong. How is him being happy make me strong? It's right there, no greater joy. You want to put joy, a smile on God's face? Walk in truth. When I walk in truth, I now establish God's strength in me. You establish God's strength in you. The thing that puts a smile on God's face today and every day is when you live in truth, when it's walked out, when it's truth that is seen. Now you've got strength. That strength, that's his strength. What puts a smile on God's face this morning? Simple. When you just walk in truth. And he actually said that actually in the preceding chapter when John is talking to three individuals here in the third chapter. In the second chapter, he's talking to the lady. And who is the lady? Oh, the church. Because I am your lady and you are my man. It's the power of love. He's talking to the church. He's the husband. Remember we talked about that a few weeks ago? The church, it's us. What does he say here? Let's take a look at that one. He says verse 4, I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in truth as we have received the commandment from the Father. Anybody receive a commandment from the Father? You're going to walk this thing out? Okay, what does it say? I now beseech thee, lady, church, us, not as though I wrote a new commandment unto thee. This isn't a new thing. I've said this all along. You're just now getting it. You just start understanding this. You finally found the foundation, and now you're going to start really living this thing. But that which we had from the beginning, that we love one another. You want to walk in truth? Love one another. Lady, church, that's what he's saying. This isn't a new commandment. That's the foundation. It's been at the foundation the whole time. We just lose sight of it. Why? Because we just start fighting, just like the couple are fighting over the color, and that room is jacked up, and you did this, and you said that, and I forgot about my foundation that was there from the very beginning. It was love. Oh, my goodness. And because that love is there, then I walk in truth. And that's what he's telling Gaius here, because it's essentially what Gaius, it was love. It was the love of Christ that was inside of Gaius. We'll go back to 3 John. Verse 5, Beloved, thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers. Gaius, you do this thing that you do so well, and what is the thing that he's doing so well? Love, love, love is all you need. It's what he just said. He's loving. Who? The brothers and the strangers. Well, who does that leave out? Nobody. Because I either consider you my brother because I know you, and maybe it's just because I had an introduction. Oh, hi, I'm Phil. Oh, hi, I'm Joe. Okay, great, brother. I don't know you. I haven't met you yet. You're a stranger. It doesn't matter. So it doesn't matter. Whoever walks into Gaius's life, this is who he treats with love and kindness. He does it faithfully. What does that mean, faithfully? It means I always treat them with love and kindness, whether they're my brother or whether they're a stranger. It really makes no difference. What's at the foundation? Christ. As though Christ would treat anybody differently? Brother? Stranger, disciple, whatever. No, it's love and kindness. It's love and kindness. He's treating them both the same. That's this. You couldn't tell. Not by his actions. His actions were consistent. See, that's what's so beautiful about Christ. I mean, Christ is really so simple. When you think about it for a second, it's like, and Paul often says that, can you just consider this? The problem is we don't consider it. We just think, nah. Would you consider the words of Christ? Would you consider what he's shown you to do? Would you consider how he sets you free from that prison? Because apart from that, you're not getting out of your prison. Listen, he wants you to walk in truth. He wants you to walk in freedom. He came for you to have freedom. He redeemed you, right? The whole thing was so that we would be redeemed. We would be free. Free to do what? Not whatever we want. Free to live like Christ. Christ is in all. Oh my goodness, I have that power and that ability today. Listen, we all recognize the fact that he is the Son of God, and he is both natural and divine when he walked this earth. But why are we any different then? We are not. We are not. So we have that power, we have that ability, just like Jesus Christ. He laid the foundation, man. It's Calvary. Man, I'm telling you right now, the blood runs deep. The blood of Jesus Christ, and I'm not talking about the actual literal blood, I'm talking about the spirit, the life-giving blood that's inside of you. That's what runs deep.
which have borne witness of thy charity. Of course, that word charity, it's agape, it's love. My ability to love without any expectation. Remember, Peter, do you love me? Yeah, Lord, I love you. Peter, do you love me? Yeah, Lord, I love you. You see, what Jesus Christ was asking Peter, he was saying, there's two loves in the Bible. There's a phileo and agape. Jesus Christ was saying, hey, Peter, do you agape me? Peter was saying, yeah, I phileo you. Yeah, no, that's not what I asked you. Do you agape me? Yeah, I phileo you. And it's okay, it's just us, because listen, why do I love? Well, I want something back in return. No, just me. Happy Valentine's Day. No. Yeah. But it's okay. It's, again, the foundation's still a good foundation. The foundation's still a good foundation. What he shows us in that is, listen, there's going to be a growth, a maturing to the love now. It's okay. Phileo's not a bad thing. Not at all. But it does got to get me to the agape. I do have to mature. I do have to come off of the milk and start eating the meat. What's the meat? To do the will of the Father. That's what Jesus Christ said. My meat is to do the will of the Father. What's the will of the Father? Agape. Agape. Because Gaius isn't asked for anything in return here. Nah, he just loves the brother and the stranger. The brother and the stranger. That's what he's saying. But it says that he did this before the church. It was in the sight of the church. Everybody saw it. It was visible. His love, you can't hide true love. Nah. True love that loves without any expectation, agape love like Jesus Christ, you can't. Nah. Everybody sees that, man. It's plain and simple. You don't have to speak words. You don't have to spell it out. You don't have to quote a Bible verse. It is seen. Come on, you know that's to be true. When you see real love, I don't know if I can give you a verse that's connected to that, but when I see it, I know it. When I see love without expectation, I know what that is. And sometimes I'm blown away by it. When I see love that loves without expectation, you know that's divine. You know that's the power of Christ that's inside of somebody. They may not even realize and know where it comes from. It don't matter. That's when I love. God is just God all by himself. He don't need you or I, anybody else. He just shows up and he just inspires that individual to just reach out and love like nobody else can love. The power of love. Celine Dion had it right now. Come on, y'all. That is such a beautiful thing this morning. But it says that what? Whom if they bring forward on their journey after a godly sort, they will do well. What does that mean on their journey? Listen, he was just helping them out in life. The journey, it's just life. But it was after a godly sort. God was involved now. God was in this thing. But how was God seen? Listen, he took the brother, he took the stranger, he loved them. It says he put him on their journey, which means he helped them. He gave them some stuff. That might have been food, that might have been clothing, that might have been money, whatever it was. He just helped them. I don't know if he preached the message or not. I don't even know if he opened his Bible or not. It didn't matter. That's what brings no greater joy than this, that my children walk in truth? This is what Gaius was doing. He wasn't, I don't even know if he preached the message, Gaius. I have no idea. But I know the power that was inside of him that was made seen, that he walked in truth, and I know he put a smile on God's face. Oh my goodness. He put a smile on God's face. Why? Because he heard and he did. He heard and he did. And he sends them on their way. Because that for his namesake, whose namesake? God's, Christ. His, not Gaius' namesake. No, for God's sake, they went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles. Means, again, he didn't go seeing who can help him, how are we going to help them. No, he just took it upon himself. Brother, stranger, Gentile, whatever, barbarian, it doesn't matter. And I love that, because as though he's going to trust anybody else besides God. Again, we can all be the Gentile too. The Gentile is just a selfish me that says, psh, you better give me something or I ain't giving you nothing. Nope. We're not going to the Gentiles for this one. I got this covered. Gaius says, I got this covered, man. I don't know who they are, but I got this covered. My God's not going to be denied, because he said it's of a godly sort. My God's not going to be denied this opportunity.
I'm going to wish them well for their journey. I'm going to make sure they're okay in this life. I'm going to help them out. Whatever it may be, I'm going to be the one that does it. To God be the glory. It's like we got this precious gift. It's like, you know, you get gifts. What do you do when you get the gift? You open it up, right? Does anybody, like, just not open the gift? Does anybody have unopened presents sitting around in their house? I don't. You got this gift. Open the gift. You got to open the gift up, man, for it to be any good. There's no greater gift. There's no greater gift. We therefore ought to receive such that we might be fellow helpers of the truth. We ought to receive who? Receive who? The brother and the stranger. You ought to receive them. Why? So that they will be fellow helpers of the truth. It'll be seen. It'll be seen. That was he preached the message. You know how he preached the message? What do you need? I'll help you. I can help you. That message preached. We ought to be that. He said, we ought to be that. We ought to do that. I mean, if the church don't do it, who's going to do it? But again, I don't know. I'm not sure if he's preaching a message or not. I don't even know if he knew scripture. I don't know. But I know what was seen, and I know what was made real. And guess what? Those that he helped, I guarantee you they remembered his name. I guarantee you they recognized the power of love. Verse 9. I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have preeminence among them, receiveth us not. Oh, my goodness. Looks like we have a scoundrel appearing on the scene now. Who is Diotrephes? Well, his name means nourished by pride. Where do I get my nourishment from? Do I have to say anything? Nope. He didn't receive him. He didn't receive him. Listen, God is about, and I love that. You said Wednesday you preached on unity. That's right. Because if none of this comes about to bring unity, there ain't no strong foundation. You got a cracked foundation. You got a cracked foundation. His foundation isn't cracked. Christ isn't cracked. So there should be a receiving. Again, did Gaius try to qualify who was his brother and who was a stranger? No. I don't even think he saw any difference. I don't even think he looked at anybody any different. I don't think he said, again, we can go the religious route, Baptist, Pentecostal, Jew, I don't think he did that. Nope, and again, according to Colossians, that doesn't matter. That's irrelevant. I don't think he said, you know, lower class, middle class, upper class. Nope. I don't think he said, painter, you know, Pepsi guy, truck driver. Nope. No. Gaius didn't do that. But it looks like Diotrephes, he did. He likely took some, but some he did not. And see, that's what pride will do. That's not, there's no foundation of pride in Christ. Amen? Because again, I love that he clearly says that. Listen, put all that away now. And why do we do that? Again, it's just protection. It's self-protection. Well, I want to protect what? Me. My feelings. Feelings, whoa, feelings. Man, they are fleeting and they will mess you up every time, church. All the time. But he wouldn't receive him. He says, verse 10, wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not content therewith. Neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and cast them out of the church. He forbiddeth them that would, yeah. So in other words, let's just say, I like Vanessa, but Sandy don't like Vanessa. Well, if I like Vanessa, and Sandy and I are friends, you like her, now I'm out. You're both out. You see, because the minute I don't relinquish my position, because if I'm gonna be faithful to Sandy, what do I gotta do? I gotta not like Vanessa, because Sandy don't like Vanessa. I gotta reject her, because she rejected her. But if I don't, then she rejects me too. Sound familiar? Oh, you're talking to so-and-so? I'm not talking to them. Oh, sorry to hear that. You're going to keep talking to them? Yeah. It's my brother. You're out. Come on, you know it's true. It's worse in family than it is anywhere else. It's worse in family than it is anywhere else. I'm not talking. Diatrophies, nourished by pride. Oh, you got the wrong foundation. You got the wrong foundation. And see this, and what was he doing? He was causing division. Gaius was causing unity. Again, he didn't distinguish. He just, I love everybody. I want to help everybody. I love everybody. I want to help anybody. I don't like the actions. It's like we talked yesterday, Bill, right? I may not like actions. Doesn't mean I reject people. Do you hear me, church? We don't reject people. We may not like the actions. I don't follow the actions. I won't, and I don't endorse or condone actions, but it doesn't mean I reject them. You see, in Diotrephes, that's what he's doing. He's rejecting them. Because even if he thought they were wrong, well, where's the Christ? Shouldn't you want to save them? Shouldn't you want to help them? Like rejecting them? How is that Christ? How is that preaching the gospel? How is that going to save them? We were watching a movie last night and they were quoting, you know, Dr. King. And he said, you know, darkness isn't gonna save darkness. Light saves darkness. Hate ain't gonna fix hate. What fix hate? Love. I mean, rejection ain't gonna create unity. How can it? No, it can't. And then we're gonna get upset with others and say, nah, then you're out too. God does not reject people. God does not endorse division. It's ridiculous. Ridiculous. What does he endorse, preacher? It's called forgiveness. Forgiveness. I don't know if they were wrong or not, by the way. That's irrelevant. Let's just say they were. Good, Diotrephes, can you forgive them? Can you still invite them anyway? Can you still love them anyway? That's the foundation. But he doesn't do it. What is he doing? And I love it, because what is he doing? He just makes empty charges. That's what the prating words. They're empty charges. They're pointless. They're empty. And he wore a red shirt on Sunday, and he can't do that. It's the most holy day. That's a prating charge. Those are prating words. They're empty. I mean, seriously? We're going to worry about that kind of stuff? I mean, we got to get past that stuff, church, or we're going to start becoming the foundation. And the malicious words, they look to hurt. Because that's what I'm trying to do. That's what we're trying to do. When I try and swing somebody away from not liking them, I'm trying to hurt them. See, now you lost me and you lost her. You know, I really got you. Right? Oh, no. We're just going to create this isolation and really hurt them. Where's Christ in that? And this dude's in the church now. It's okay. I mean, again, sometimes in our silliness, we do silly things like this. Because we forgot about the foundation that was laid from the beginning. Love. Love. Verse 11. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, and he that doeth evil hath not seen God. Diotrephes, you haven't even seen God. You don't know what he looks like. You have no idea what he's even saying. Why? Because you're causing division. Read Proverbs 6. It's the abomination to God. Those that cause division, those that with the lying tongue, swift to shed innocent blood. It's the division. It's the divisive nature of the Adam man. It's the old nature. But what does he say? Did he say, hey, reject him? Did he say, hey, don't ever talk to him, get away from him? No, he says, just, hey, Gaius, whatever you, don't do that. Don't you do that. You keep loving brothers and strangers. Don't you do that. Just don't do that. That's all. Just don't do that. He didn't say anything against Diotrephes here. He didn't reject him. He didn't say get away from him. He said, listen, just don't do that. They haven't seen God yet. They just haven't seen him yet. They just haven't identified with the nature and the character of our God yet. Remember they said that? Jesus said that. He says, those that are trying to kill me, they think they're doing God's work. The reason I'm injuring you, I'm doing God's work. Why else would I be slandering you? I'm doing God's work. Because he don't like you. You're a crook. You're no good. Therefore, there is no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. Isn't that what it says in Romans? What does no condemnation mean? It means there is none exist. I don't condemn people. How do I condemn people? When I speak poorly of them. What? Again, there may have been a wrong, but speaking about it isn't Christ. That's not Christ. There is now no condemnation. That word condemnation, it means I'm just bringing against. I'm bringing a charge against for whatever the case. What does love do? Peter actually says that. What does real love do? It covers a multitude of sin. My ability to love, it covers the wrongs that are done to me. You cover them. You don't condemn. Love covers. Love covers. Love covers. Love covers. This is what's seen. This is what's seen. Verse 12. Demetrius hath a good report of all men. How many men did Demetrius have a good report of? All men. Is it possible, church, that some of these men may have just done something silly? Is that possible? What was in his report? It was a good report. He found the foundation. Because even if you think about Diotrephes, I can always go to Diotrephes and say, you got a good foundation, my brother. Christ set this foundation. Let me tell you something about the foundation that you got. I can still have a good report. The good report is Christ. You can always find the Christ. You can always find the Christ. He didn't pick and choose. No, this gentleman here says that he had a good report of all men and of truth itself. You want to make truth real? Have a good report to say. Have something nice to say about somebody. Yeah, but I don't know if I can find something nice to say. Yes, you can. The foundation is Christ. You can. The foundation is Christ. Yes, you can. Have a good report. Then truth itself will be made real. Congratulations. You just took God's truth and made it real. How? By having a good report of all men. Of all men. Listen, I know we can all pick out the foolish things we do in life. Please, is anybody worn out from that one? Like, seriously. Oh, did you see what, I mean, I'm exhausted. That is, listen, can we move on? Can we move on, church? Can we find a good report? That's what we ought to be running and yelling and screaming and looking to do. That's the journey. I know we can find the silly knucklehead stuff. Please. Got that one. I mean, we learned that one when we were 10 and 12 and 16 and 49. Oopsie. Can we move on? Can we move on already? Have a good report for all men. And Demetrius, I love Demetrius. You know what his name means? It means he's a silversmith. He works with silver. Who works with silver? Silver, it's a picture of redemption. Those that redeem, those that look to reconcile, those that look to unite. Redemption. How are you going to redeem the world? With a good report. With a good report. That's how you're going to do it. With a good report. Amen. Verse 13. I had many things to write, but I will not with ink and pen write unto thee. But I trust I shall shortly see thee, and we shall speak face to face. Peace be unto thee. Our friends salute thee. Greet the friends by name. What name are we supposed to greet them by? Oh, it is the Christ that's inside of us. The good report, it's done face-to-face. It's done face-to-face. How do I do that? We just encourage one another in Christ. We speak well of one another. And when I don't, what am I doing? It's really a lie. That's the lie. That's why our loins have to be girded about with truth. That's the strong foundation. That's why we walk in truth. It's got to be in truth. Really, anything else is a lie. Anything else is a lie. Because then I say, what I say, when I say things that are not, if I choose to create labels and say, yep, you're from this denomination and no good, and this one maybe, and this one definitely, now I've just lost sight of my foundation and I don't have truth. Because again, he clearly said that all of that stuff doesn't matter. Christ is in all. That is the truth, church. That is the truth. Doesn't matter your background, doesn't matter your nationality, doesn't matter your religion, none of that matters. Matter of fact, Paul even says that, why do you strive over these things? It's wasted effort, it's wasted time. It's the revealing of Christ that's inside of us. This is the truth. This is the truth. You know, and I couldn't help, brother, but go back to Ezra, since we were talking about Ezra, and of course, as the altar is being built here. And again, the foundation is there, right? We didn't rebuild this foundation. Like, my brother Rich was here yesterday, and God bless him. He is he is the baddest dude on this earth when it comes to this stuff. I told my brother, I couldn't even keep up with him. He just like, brr, his, and thank God for him, because we would have never gotten this far. But the foundation was already there. We didn't lay the foundation now, church. It was a good foundation. But we did build upon it now. You've got to, you and I, we build upon this foundation now. Again, I can't, it's just not, I don't just lay bare with a foundation of nothing. What gets built upon it? What gets built upon it is more Christ, more unity, more love, more forgiveness, more kindness. And, now we're building on this thing. Listen, God says, I give you the foundation. He's not going to build the whole thing by himself. Do you honestly think that? Then why does he need us? Why does he? Listen, I am the master builder. I laid the foundation. Now, can the rest of you now mature and build on this thing for me? Let me see some stuff, some love, some kindness, some strength. You build on it. You build on it. This is the foundation. We build on it, church. We build on it. Brother or stranger, we build on it. Love. Love. But I was reminded in Ezra, so I'd like to just look at this one verse. It's in Ezra. I believe it's chapter 3. And, of course, you know, you have Ezra, Nehemiah, and Zerubbabel. They essentially rebuilt Jerusalem, right? They built the church. They rebuilt the walls. The 30 amigos. Ezra was one of them. Give me a second, church, sorry. All right, here we go. Ezra, chapter 3. We'll start in verse 10. And when the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, they set the priests in their apparels with trumpets, and the Levites and the sons of Asaph with cymbals to praise the Lord after the ordinance of David, the king of Israel. They laid the foundation of the temple, and what are they doing? Man, they're getting everybody ready. They're getting them dressed up. They're making sure they got their instruments. Because this is going to be a time for celebration. This is going to be a time for revival. Revival. We got our church back. We have a place to now go and worship and sing and praise God. Man, they're getting everybody ready for this thing. This is like big time. It's just a foundation now. It's just a foundation. But it was enough. It was enough to get everybody and get them all dressed up and get their nice red shirt on. You know what I'm saying? And they're getting them together, and they're getting their instruments together, and what happens? Verse 11. And they sang together. This is an interesting concept, church. They sang together by chorus and praising and giving thanks unto the Lord. Who? God. Unto the Lord. Why? Because he is good. What's at the foundation? God is good. Thank you, Jesus. And what? His mercy endureth forever. And all the people shouted with great shout, and they praised God because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. What's laid at the foundation of your house? First, God is good. He really is a good God, church. And what else? His mercy endures forever. His mercy. That was at the foundation when they laid the foundation of the temple. What's at the foundation of your temple? God is good. And his mercy can never run out. You know why? Because he's built a church to provide mercy to the world. Amen. Mercy. Mercy. That's a strong foundation. And I love it because can we change that, church? No, God is good and his mercy will endure forever. Because sometimes I might be like Diotrephes and I choose to reject somebody or not like them because of the color of their shirt or what they say or what they did or what their nationality is or what church they came from. And God says, man, God is good, man. My mercy endures forever now. Oh, my goodness. He says, I need you to love them anyway. I need you to walk in truth and love them just like I expect them to love you. This is what's at the foundation. This is what and that can never, ever change, church, that God is good. That's just, listen, it's just a fundamental principle that you got to hold on to always, no matter what you see, face, house crumbling down, sinking in the rug. I don't care. God is good, and his mercy can never run out. Amen. Master worship team, if they'll come back up. We sang that song the cornerstone, which again, the cornerstone, the foundation, it is Christ. It is Christ. And I pray as we sing that we give thanks to God for the foundation that's already been laid inside of us, and that God is good and his mercy endures forever. And we just live it out each and every day. Amen. Why don't you stand while we sing it?
Process here. I think this is maybe our third weekend. You know, you come to church on Sunday and you don't see what you're supposed to see on a Sunday. You know, you're supposed to see a pretty building, right? You're supposed to see everything in place and in order. You're not supposed to see dirt on the ground or broken walls, right? You're not supposed to see that. And sometimes when you see the broken walls and the dirt on the floor, even though the broken walls are there and the dirt's on the floor, you don't want anybody to see it. So you want to put paper up and maybe they won't see that there's no wall there. And you want to get a wet mop, Bill, and you want to mop the rug. I've never mopped a rug before, but we'll do that because we don't want anybody to see our dirt. You know, as if God's not doing something in our lives. And you know, the foundation, beautiful pastor, the foundation is always solid. There's a strong foundation in all of our lives that's God. Hallelujah. But you know, he does take us through the construction process. And the truth of the matter is, construction process ain't overnight, you know. Sometimes you want God to do something in your life right away. And sometimes you go through seasons of stuff, right? Seasons, man. And like, you know, in the midst of it all, you want to put some paper up and some wipe up the dust so nobody knows what the heck you're going through. But you know, you're going to look at these walls for about 8 more weeks. You're going to come in here and you're going to see broken walls and broken floors, and you're going to see dirt. But the foundation's solid. We're going to go on because life goes on no matter what God's doing in your life. No matter what God is doing in your life, life goes on. And know this, when it's all said and done, the dust is going to settle. The walls are going to be rebuilt. There's going to be lights and glory all around, not only in this temple, but in the real temple. You are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Amen. God is going to rebuild you. You're going to be better than you were before. Better, faster. No, that's not the one. Better, stronger. Well, let's pray, everybody. Lord Jesus, we love you, and we're grateful, my Lord God. Sometimes we think we're the only ones that you're doing something with. We think we're the only ones who have walls that are broken down and dust and debris that's everywhere in our lives, my Lord. But Lord, we're comforted by knowing that you broke down the walls in our life. You created the rubble so you can do something beautiful. And as Pastor Phil said, we are part of the rebuilding process. So, Lord, thank you. We are part of this rebuilding process. And I do believe that the season that we're in, it's a rebuilding process. We've been through the hard times. I believe that. And I see that you're restoring and bringing glory back into our lives. So let it be done, my Lord God. It's your timetable. It will be done little by little. So even the next weeks as we come into this house and we see the progress, we know, my Lord God, it's a picture of what you're doing in each and every one of our lives. So, Lord, let us continue to see the imagery in front of our eyes to know what you're doing in our lives. So in your name we pray, and everybody says, amen. Amen. God bless you all.